am Miss Barbara. How are you this morning? Did you enjoy your spring break? Are you ready to go back to school? You probably aren't, but you know what? Good school is good for you. Just like church is good for you, and prayer is good for you, and Sunday school is good for you, and time with God is super, super good for you. But you knew that, didn't you? You absolutely did know that that was good for you. Just like a lot of things are super good for you, it's always good to make sure that you make time for them every day and every week. How about we start our Sunday school off with the Bible verse of the week, like we always do? Read along with me if you can read, and if not, listen along, okay? Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. So we're going to continue our story, even though Easter has already happened. We're still talking about Easter. Easter isn't something that just happens for one day. Easter is a celebration. Easter is a time of year. Easter is a long story. It's something that we don't ever want to forget. We just don't want to have one day and then be done with it. Easter is such a special gift from God that we don't want to take it for granted. We want to make sure that we treasure it and that we remember each and every part. So we know the story. We know that he came very triumphantly through Jerusalem with the palms. And what did he say? What did the people say? Hosanna. And he comes through and the people are happy, but it doesn't take long before they start to not be as happy, right? And then he's going to have a special dinner with his disciples. Do you remember what we called that? The Last Supper. And then he's going to pray with his disciples, and then he's going to be betrayed by one of his disciples. Do you remember which one betrayed him and turned him in to the soldiers? Judas is going to turn him in. He's going to be arrested. He is going to be brought before the Roman rulers. He is going to be tried. And the people in charge are actually going to get out of it. They're going to think, oh, I don't know that I want this on my hands. He hasn't really done anything wrong. And so Pilate's going to say, well, we've got this one guy over here who's done something bad, and we've got Jesus. Which one of them do you want me to crucify? And the people are actually going to say, which one? They're going to say Jesus. Did Jesus really do anything wrong? He didn't. So his hands are tied. He said, well, they spoke. That's what they want. Sometimes when we're a crowd of people, we kind of make decisions that maybe we wouldn't make if we were by ourselves. You ever notice that? Sometimes when we're with a group of friends, we might do things that we would not do if we were doing something with ourselves or with a friend that we know who makes the right choices. So he is going to be tried. He's going to be put on a cross. We know he's going to be put into the tomb, and the large what's going to be rolled? The large stone's going to be put in front of it. And then how many days later before the women go to the tomb? 3 days. They're going to go to the tomb to prepare him for burial. And what's going to happen when they get there? The stone will have been rolled away. And who's going to be there? Who's going to be there? An angel is going to be there. And he's going to say, why? He'll look for the living among the dead. And then they're going to see whom? Mary Magdalene's going to see whom? She thinks it's a gardener, but it's not. Who is it? It's Jesus. She's going to see Jesus, and she's going to run, and she's going to go and tell the disciples. And they're going to come back, not believing her, and look for themselves. And so the story is going to continue, because now Jesus is alive. He has risen. He has come back. And so the story of Easter actually continues. And so today we're going to talk about another one of those moments where Jesus shows himself. So Jesus shows himself at the tomb. Then he is going to appear to the disciples. We talked about that a little bit last week. Do you remember how they were locked up in the upper room?
And he comes through the locked room, and he appears to them in the room, and all of them are just taken aback. This is going to be the third time he's going to show himself to the disciples. What do you like to eat for breakfast? What do you eat for breakfast? I'm not a really big breakfast person, but I like waffles and strawberries. I usually just get the frozen kind because it takes a really long time to make waffles. What do you eat? Raise your hand if you like eggs. Raise your hand if you like pancakes. Raise your hand if you like cereal. If you like cereal. Raise your hand if you like muffins. Raise your hand if you like donuts. Raise your hand if you eat fruit, like fruit for breakfast. There are lots of yummy things. You see my pictures, lots of funny, yummy things, like there's croissants and eggs and juice and milk and yogurt and eggs and bacon and juice and toast and all sorts of yummy things that you can eat for breakfast. And what do you think that Jesus is going to eat for breakfast in this story? Fish. Have you ever eaten fish for breakfast? Raise your hand if you've eaten fish for breakfast. I have never eaten fish for breakfast. I'm not a big fan of fish anyway. Fish is just not my thing. But Jesus is going to eat fish for breakfast. Now, that's not really that unusual for them. They didn't have a Walmart. They couldn't just go out. Or they couldn't go to Chick-fil-A and get the chicken minis. Raise your hand if you like the chicken minis. So they couldn't just go, and they couldn't go to the IHOP or someplace like that and get a yummy breakfast and sit around and talk about their day. That didn't work. So it would not have been unusual for them to eat a fish breakfast. So that's what they're going to do together when they see Jesus. But at this point, they've now seen him. Some of them seen him twice. John has seen him twice. And Peter has seen him twice. The rest of the disciples have seen him. This will be their third time. So they know that it's Jesus. And they know that they're not going to see him too many more times. They don't even question him. They know it's him. So they come ashore and they have a breakfast with him. And so I ask how many of you have eaten fish for breakfast. But I wonder how many of you have ever gone fishing. Is that something that you do? Do you like to do that? Do you like to do the fishing? Do you fish in a boat? Do you fish on a pier? Do you fish at the beach or at the lake? So I asked some of your parents to send me some pictures of you fishing, and I got a whole lot of them, and I have to say that I was very impressed with some of your skills.
Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. As Jesus was walking beside the sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Said, and I will make you fishers of men. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Yeah, fishers of men. And at once they left their nets and followed him. Yeah, they followed him.
Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Yeah, come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make
fishers of men. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men. Come, follow me. And I will make you fishers of men. Come, follow me.
You all make very good fishermen. And I know we've talked before about being fishers of men. And I hope that's something that you are also doing, that you're also sharing how much you love God and how much you love Jesus, and that you're telling other people, you're telling your friends, and you're telling your neighbors and your classmates, and hopefully that you're also being fishers of people and fishers of friends and helping them see how much you love God, and so that they want to be people of God as well. So I loved seeing all your pictures, even though Fish completely grossed Barbara out. I really did love seeing how much joy it brought to you, and a lot of you were doing with your dads and your moms and maybe uncles, and some of you with your siblings, and you could see how happy it made you, and that made me happy to see how much fun that you were having. So now I want to share the story with you that we're talking today about Easter and how this Easter story continues, and about Jesus and his breakfast with his friends. So behold the Lamb of God.
Your only Son, no sin to hide, but you have sent him from your side to walk upon guilty son and to become the Lamb of God. Your gift of love they crucified.
Jesus was alive again. The disciples had seen him with their own eyes. But where was he now? When would they see him again? And what were they supposed to do in the meantime? I'm going fishing, Peter said. We'll go with you, said Thomas, Nathaniel, James, John, and two other disciples. They climbed into their fishing boat and rowed out to the lake. They threw their fishing nets into the water. Kersplash. Then they waited and waited and waited. They waited all night, but they did not catch any fish. Not one. Just as morning came, Peter and the others saw a man standing on the shore. But they didn't know who it was. The man called to them, Friends, do you have any fish? No, they answered, not one. Throw your net over on the right side of the boat, the man said, and you'll find some. I guess we could try it, the disciples said to one another. They threw the big heavy net into the water on the right side of the boat. Suddenly the net was filled with fish. Lots and lots and lots of fish. Something like this happened once before. Peter, James, and John remembered. That man on the shore is the Lord, John said. Peter was so glad to see Jesus again that he jumped into the water and swam to shore while the other disciples brought the boat. There on the beach, Peter saw Jesus and a little fire. Bread and fish were warming over the fire. Bring some of your fish that you caught, Jesus said, and let us have breakfast. So Peter pulled the net full of fish onto the beach and brought some of the fish to Jesus. When the breakfast was ready, everyone gathered around the fire, and Jesus served the bread and fish to his friends. Oh, how good it was for the disciples to be with Jesus again. Then Peter heard Jesus ask, Peter, do you love me more than these? You know that I do, Lord, Peter asked. Peter, do you love me? Jesus asked again. You know that I do, Lord, Peter asked. Peter said, Peter, do you love me? Jesus asked again. That made three times Jesus had asked Peter the same question, just as Peter had denied knowing Jesus three times at the high priest's house. Lord, you know everything, Peter said. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep, Jesus said, and follow me. Jesus had forgiven Peter and given him important work to do. So what did you think of that story? I like this part of the Easter story because his friends were so sad when they lost him. And not only were they sad, I think they were very upset with themselves. Have you ever made a mistake and you've been so upset and you don't know what to do to fix it? I think we've all been in those situations, whether we're little or we're big. We've made a mistake and we've done something that we shouldn't have, or we've done something that we regret. And we don't know how to fix it. We've tried, maybe we've said we're sorry. Maybe we've tried to do something about it, but it still feels yucky inside. And this was an opportunity for those disciples, those friends, to kind of make things better with Jesus. If you remember when Jesus was being arrested and he was kind of being held, and there was a lot of commotion and people were angry at the time, they kind of scattered and they hid. And if you remember, Peter denied him. Do you remember when Jesus told Peter, "You will deny me three times." He said, "Absolutely not, Lord. No, I would not. I would never do that." And people will say, "He was a friend of Jesus." And he says, no, I wasn't. And he's going to do that three times. And then when the rooster crows, he's going to realize what he did and he's going to feel so bad about it. The other disciples are also going to run and hide. And I think they're going to feel very bad about it too, because they realize what they did. They abandoned Jesus when he needed them the most. And this is an opportunity. They come together over breakfast, even though it's fish, and they have an opportunity to kind of say, "I'm sorry, Lord." And Jesus is going to basically say, "It's okay. I still love you." Do your parents do that when you make a mistake? Do they say, "I still love you, even though you've messed up"? That's kind of what happens here. And they all needed that. They all needed to know that Jesus still loved them and that he forgave them. Now, before we go any further, let's think about which part of the Bible this story comes from. Look at our clues. Who's involved with this story? We've got Jesus and we've got several of the disciples involved in this story. So based on those clues, where could this Bible story come from? If you said the New Testament, you are correct, and you're probably picking up on that part, that if Jesus is in it, where does it come from? From the New Testament. Good job, guys. This is Tobias's game. Do you have one of these at home? It's a fishing game. And you turn it on, and the little fish's mouth's open, and you try to catch one. And he loves this little game. Do you have a little fishing game like this at your house? So they're out in the boat, and they've been out all night. Now, I have never really been fishing on a boat. I have no desire to fish, but even as a kid, I don't remember fishing on a boat. Now, they wouldn't have just had their poles and yucky worms and stuff. They were fishing with nets. So for, I would say, all night would be hours and hours and hours. And they keep pulling in. They're not getting any fish at all, no matter what they do. So when the morning comes, they see a man on the shore. And he says, "Throw it on the other side of the boat." And this has happened before in the Bible. You might remember this story as well. And they're like, "Well, it can't hurt." They're probably tired and frustrated. And think about everything that's happened to them in the past couple of weeks. It's been a lot. It has been a very trying time, a very sad time, a very stressful time for them. So they throw it overboard. And then what happens? It is so full. It's over 100. It's just hundreds of fish. And they pull it in, and the Bible says that it actually was so many, but it didn't tear. So it makes me think that in an ordinary circumstances, if that many fish were in that net, it probably would have ripped. And they reel it in, so it's almost as if it made up for all those hours and hours and hours. So do you think all those fish were just waiting on the other side of that boat? Probably not. What do you think happened? Like, it's be kind of a miracle, don't you think? Jesus stepped in. Jesus stepped in and kind of did his thing. I would call it Jesus intervention, a miracle kind of a situation where he allowed fish to become on that side of the boat for the net to take them up into the boat. So at that moment, they knew who the man on the side of the shore was. Now, Jesus could have walked off. He could have said, okay, have a nice day. But he didn't do that. Do you think that if people were not very nice to you, or maybe your friends didn't stand up for you, that you would come back and say it's okay? That'd be a hard thing to do. It's the right thing to do, but it'd be hard, don't you think? And Jesus knows what happened. He knows that Peter denied him. He knows that the other disciples fled. He knows that Judas had betrayed him. He knows all the things that happened. He knows that disciples went and locked themselves in the upper room, and that they didn't come out. That he knows that they didn't believe Mary Magdalene. He knows lots of things, but he says, come. Come and have breakfast with me. And this is his moment to say, we're still friends and I still love you. Now, Jesus is going to talk to Peter. Peter is Jesus's favorite. Maybe his bestie, his best friend. And he says something to him. Do you remember what he says? He says, he asked him a question. Do you love me, Peter? How many times has he asked Peter that? He's going to ask him that 3 times. And does Peter say no? Peter says, yes, Lord. Yes, I love you. And how, so the 3 times kind of cancels out the 3 times that Peter said he didn't know Jesus that fateful night. So that's his way of telling Peter, I forgive you for each of those times. Then he's going to tell him something else. He says, if you love me, then, do you remember what he said? He said, feed my sheep. Is he a sheep? Does he have sheep? Does he have a pasture somewhere? Does he have a farm? No. Who are Jesus' sheep? His people. His people, the people that he's preaching to. So what is Jesus telling Peter to do if he says, feed my sheep? He's saying, take care of the people that I was preaching to, that I told God about. Continue to take care of them. Continue to bless them. Continue to show them love and compassion. Now, he wants Peter to kind of continue on doing what it is that he was doing while he was here on earth. So what else is Jesus telling him then if he says, feed my sheep? He's telling him, I can't feed them anymore. I can't take care of them anymore. Why wouldn't Jesus be able to take care of them anymore? What's going to happen? He's sitting right there eating fish for breakfast, so why wouldn't he be able to take care of them anymore? He knows that the time is coming for him to go to heaven and be with God the Father. He knows his time is coming, so he needs Peter to kind of take over where he left off. So he's having this moment with his friends to say, all is forgiven. I still love you. And we had a wonderful thing. And we did great, great work while we were together. And now it is your job to continue on what I was doing. Don't let it go away. Don't let it stop. Make sure that people still know how much God loves them. Make sure that people are still taken care of. That's what he wants to continue to happen. He came to earth for a reason, and he died for a reason. Now, I had the Sunbeam Singers put together a song so that we wouldn't forget the Easter story and that we would remember everything that Jesus did just for us. Thank you, Sunbeam Singers. That was that's a hymn that we sing in church sometimes, and it helps tell the story of Easter so that we don't forget what it is that he did, and then what he's asking Peter to continue on. And then after Peter falls away and Peter passes away, who continues that? Does it just go away? Did we stop forgetting about Jesus and God? No, it continues on, and that passes and passes, and now we have preachers and reverends and other and ministers and lots of people who take on that job that Jesus had and Peter had and the disciples had, and they continue on. We have missionaries, and we have people just like you and me that continue to tell other people about Jesus and how much God loves them and love on them, and do everything that we can to make sure that they know that they have a purpose and that they are loved. So how about a Miss Barbara trivia? You like that? So I've got some Bible fish tales, and I want you to see if you can figure out which one I'm talking about. Can you do it with me? Okay. So here's the first one. This Bible fish tale is a tale of a man sent by God to a place called Nineveh. And if he would just have gone, he could have avoided 3 smelly days inside an underwater belly. Which Bible fish tale is that? Nineveh and a man and a belly. Jonah and the whale. We call it a whale in the Bible. It does say a big fish. It could be a beast. So Jonah and the whale. He didn't want to go to Nineveh. God said, go to Nineveh and tell the people. And he said, no, I don't want to do that. And then what happened? He ran and got on a boat headed toward Tarsus, and then the storm came, and he said, it's my fault, throw me overboard. So the people did it. The people on the boat threw him overboard, and he got swallowed up. All right, you ready for the next one? Okay. In this tale, Jesus tells 2 sets of brothers that they could catch a lot more than fish if they would drop their nets on the sand. Which fish tale is that from the Bible? 2 sets of brothers dropping their nets. Which one? When he tells them about being fishers of men. Do you remember that part? When Jesus very first starts his ministry and he meets the 4 of the disciples, the 2 sets of brothers, and he says, come and I shall make you fishers of men. All right, ready for the next one? This is the tale of Peter and the need for some money to pay taxes. Poor Peter will find a very unusual place where the money is hidden. Do you remember this story where they needed money to get when they were in another city and you had to pay some taxes to kind of go to a different city? And they're looking, they don't really have enough for the taxes, and they need to pay some money. And even though the disciples are arguing, well, we really shouldn't.